I will walk in the wind to meet you, Jesus, to let you wash my feet. But I don't want to. I would rather stay comfortable in my pew, in the warm, away from your towels and water and offers of forgiveness, for I know what you mean, what you ask, what you give. But I will come, for I cannot stay here alone, and I cannot run elsewhere, for I know that you are waiting, welcoming. And I know that only you can heal me and hold me. So I will come with empty hands to your supper, empty hands and dirty feet. I will come as your guest, and with water, bread, and wine, you will make me whole and set me free to serve you.
Evening. Good evening. We gather to begin the three most holy days in our Christian calendar today, and it ends on Sunday. And it's a whole journey of celebration and feast and meals and torture and death and silence on Saturday and then resurrection. The whole gamut of human feelings and emotions. So we begin by lighting candles, and we will do it remembering all the people throughout history who have assembled around the table to do what Jesus did in his Last Supper. They gathered in an upper room to share a meal, and the names of the apostles were these:
Simon called Peter, his brother Andrew, James and his brother John, the sons of Zebedee, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James the son of Alphaeus, Thaddeus, Simon the patriot, and Judas Iscariot,
along with some women who had been healed. Among them were
Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Susanna, and many
seeing that we are surrounded with such a great cloud of witnesses to faith,
we join them now to praise your name.
For all those who have kept the light of the gospel burning down through the centuries,
we give thanks.
For all who have gathered around a table to keep this remembrance alive, those who have gathered in humble homes, in hiding in times of persecution, in simple churches, or in grand cathedrals,
we give thanks.
for those who passed the light of Christ on to us and have now gone before us.
We give thanks.
Come, Lord Jesus, take your rightful place as host at this your table.
God speaks to us. God speaks to us
in the words and actions of the prophets and sages.
God speaks to us
in your word made flesh, the beloved child of Mary, Jesus the Emmanuel.
God speaks to us
in the lives of others, especially the poor.
God speaks to us
in mysterious words and ways. You may be seated.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Beloved, I pass on to you the tradition the Lord gave to me. On the same night the Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread in his hands, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it and said, "This is my body, broken for you. Keep doing this so that you and all who come after will have a vivid reminder of me." After they had finished dinner, he took the cup and in the same way said, "This cup is the new covenant, executed in my blood. Keep doing this, and whenever you drink it, you and all who come after will have a vivid reminder of me." Every time you taste this bread, and every time you place the cup to your mouths and drink, you are declaring the Christ's death, which is the ultimate expression of his faithfulness and love until he comes again. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us,
thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ according to John. Now before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already decided that Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, would betray Jesus. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from supper, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean, and you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason, he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had reclined again, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, slaves are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them." When he had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I'm going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Seated. I chose the first reading from a very strange Bible called the Voice Bible, and simply because one reason is how they translated that word. After each words, when Jesus takes the bread and takes the wine, at the end it says, "Do this so that you and all who come after me will have a vivid reminder." And I like that phrase, a vivid reminder. There was a woman, her name was Celeste Crosterosa. She lived in 18th century Italy, near Naples. And of her writing, she was a mystic. She wrote about prayer, and she had this deep relationship with Christ. And for her whole life, she described it as having viva memoria, she would call it. So what she meant by that is, we are called to be vivid reminders of Christ. And I think I would just leave you with that. What a beautiful way to live, as simply being viva memoria, memories that are alive, that what we do, Christ may be seen through us. Wouldn't that be a great project? And this is precisely what we do. We're going to wash the feet, and we're washing feet two times here. We're washing feet here symbolically, and over there we have a group of our parishioners who are washing the feet by serving meals. So it's two ways of different of washing feet. But whatever we do, in all that we do, may we always have this calling to be living memories, vivid reminders of Christ. We're going to be setting up now for the washing of the feet. We'll ask the altar guild to help us as they set up. And what this year we're going to do, we'll have two stations. Hugh and I will start off by washing feet, and then we'll step back, and the next person will be washing feet. As we do every year, you're invited to do it cyclically. We do, anybody who would like to come to experience both having your feet washed first and then washing the feet of the one who was before you, of the one who will be coming after you. This year, what we're going to be doing, the Altar Guild is going to be helping us by setting up, instead of filling the basins with water, they will be placing a towel so you can put your feet on top of the towel. They'll pour a little bit of water for you to wash, and then just fold the towel on top of the feet, nice, dry, and then we'll put them in our hamper over this side, okay? So hopefully that will be smooth and easy, because the most important thing is all, as you come forward, how can I be a living memory? This is symbolic, but how can I do this out in the world? Of course, not necessarily washing feet, but different ways in which we are called, or we can be living memories of Christ. Both feet is okay, yeah. So again, there will be, and then the altar guild will put more towels for the next person. They will be pouring the water for you, so you would only need to clean and dry, okay? So let's stand as you're able to say this prayer before the washing of feet. On page 10. God of dirty hands and tired feet, taking people as they come, kneeling and healing, touching where others turn away. Forgive us when we want to be too clean. Forgive us when we despise life for the messy business it is. If we are too proud to admit our brokenness, if we keep hidden what needs refreshing, how can you care for us? We can be open to God's grace when we are ready to move from distance to involvement, from intent to touch. Then you will wash the feet that tire on rocky roads. You will care and heal beyond our wildest expectations. I invite you now to come forward that I may recall whose servant I am by following the example of my master. And by those who are watching online, you might just do something symbolically, maybe even in your own head. How would you wash? With whom would you wash feet today? But come, remembering Christ's admonition that what will be done for you is also to be done by you to others. For a servant is not greater than his master, nor is one who is sent greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them.
Thank you.
every time I do this ceremony, it is always, the most difficult thing is to allow someone else to wash your feet, right? When we say, let us be a living memory of Christ, we always think of how I'm going to serve, how I'm going to do, how I'm going to. But I think this exercise invites us, if we are to be living memories, we need to allow ourselves to be washed, to be vulnerable to each other. And it's always difficult. So I invite you to think, how can we be living memory of Christ by being vulnerable to each other? Let us pray for the world and church.
In the company of Jesus and in unity with his faithful followers in years past and in our present day, let us offer our prayers responding, Kyrie eleison. For the gift of humility, that we may mirror the servanthood of Jesus, bending the knee of our hearts to all whose feet have journeyed a long distance and whose hands have washed away the burdens of others, let us pray. Kyrie eleison. For peace throughout the world, especially in Ukraine, and all places where the lust for power fosters tyranny and war, let us pray. Kyrie eleison. For the courage to face our own unfaithfulness, the kisses of deception, the subtle betrayals, our spiritual sleepiness, that in turning to Christ, we may receive the grace that changes lives. Let us pray. Kyrie eleison. For those who keep watch this night, that in watching they may be found, in seeking they may be filled with the Spirit, and in waiting they may find peace. Let us pray. Kyrie eleison. For those who keep watch every night, the hungry, the homeless, the fearful, that Christ might find them in their gardens of Gethsemane, thank you, and not leave them in despair. Let us pray. In thanksgiving for this Eucharistic meal, which gathers us into the fellowship of all the beloved, uniting us, may we increase in appreciation of this mystery. Kyrie eleison.
Please be seated. Just announcements tomorrow. We will have, this liturgy has a lot of symbols. We'll celebrate the Eucharist now. And after the Eucharist, I'll be reserving the sacrament over here. You'll notice, meaning the bread, the consecrated bread on this little side altar, and there'll be flowers there. And for many people, this is sort of like the Garden of Gethsemane. It's where Jesus spent this night. And you know, this was the night he was betrayed. This was the night when he was really, really in anguish. Remember when he's crying and even sweating blood, he was so afraid. And his disciples kept falling asleep. And for three times he went, hey, can you keep on? Hey, I really need your support in this moment. And they would just fall asleep and he felt really abandoned. So for many people, staying a little bit and just in prayer, thinking about all the people who are alone, or even ourselves who are alone, to feel Christ understanding us in a very deep and meaningful way. The service today will end strangely, without any blessing, any goodbye, any song. We'll end like in total silence. We will be cleaning up the altar with all the things are removed. I'll clean the altar with a piece of the palms and I'll throw it on the floor in a very dramatic way, I hope, that Hugh taught me. As a sign of, what is this night of betrayal and be imprisoned. And we will exit the church through here, so we won't go out. So the whole idea is to leave it very, very sparse. People, usually the idea when we have this ceremony, people come over here, have a prayer for the Blessed Sacrament, and then whenever you feel ready, you can go. Tomorrow we'll have the service of Good Friday, same time, 5:30. We'll have the Passion according to John. We will read other readings, but also the veneration of the cross. And we will take communion from the reserved sacrament, because we don't celebrate the Eucharist. We will also end the service tomorrow without any blessing or anything. Saturday, it's a day of quiet. Usually it's a day where Jesus was buried. There was not much going on. In some tradition, that is where there's a veneration to Mary, especially Mary in her solitude of just having lost her son and what went through her heart in that day. At night, we will meet. That is Saturday, but it's really Sunday. Saturday at 8 p.m., we'll have the ceremony of the fire over here. We'll light the new fire. Hopefully, it's dark enough at 8. We'll turn on the lights. We will walk with our candles lit. With a big candle, we'll put it here. We'll have the readings of the night, the vigil readings. There are several readings. And then we'll end the service, because it's half of it. We will go home. Those who want to stay here are welcome to stay the night in the church. And then the second part of that service is at 6 in the morning for the sunrise service. So we will pick up where we left, the reading of the epistle, the gospel. We will have blessing of the water, filling up, as you all notice, it's sand, it's dry. This will become, again, water, fertile. And we will celebrate the Eucharist for Easter. And of course, we will have a regular 10 o'clock service, Easter service. So those are the things we're having this week. Oh, yes, and at 6 in the morning, because night will be very dark, we'll not light these things, these lights over here, because we're pretending it's still, it's night. In the morning service, when we sing the Gloria, we invite you all to bring bells. And the idea is like we're supposed to have not rung any bell. It has all been the terrible clacker. And it's the idea of just rejoicing with all the noise of the bell ringing. So bring anything you have that makes a beautiful sound. Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving, and make good your vows to the Most High. The offering today and tomorrow is dedicated completely to be sent to Palestine, Israel. Since more than 70-something years, always this offering is sent to the Diocese of Jerusalem and the Middle East. And they really need it at this moment in their history. Thank you for your generosity. Please stand as you're able. We continue our prayer on page 14. Blessed are you, O God, for you have brought forth bread from the earth. Blessed are you, O God,
for you have created the fruit of the vine.
In the beginning you watered the earth that humankind might have food and drink. You gave to your servant Sarah bread to strengthen her family on their journey and wine to make them glad. You called Moses and his people out of bondage and refreshed them with food in the wilderness. You gave Mary and Jesus their daily bread to share. And here at your table, you offer us bread and wine for the journey to nourish us as sons and daughters. And so that with all our sisters and brothers before us and beside us, we praise you from our hearts for your unending greatness. Lord Jesus Christ,
present with us now,
as we do in this place what you did in an upstairs room,
breathe your spirit upon us,
and upon this bread and this wine,
that they may be heaven's food and drink for us, renewing, sustaining, and making us whole,
and that we may be your body on earth,
loving and caring.
Among friends gathered around a table, Jesus took bread, and having blessed it, he broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." In the same way, he took wine, and having given thanks for it, he poured it out and gave the cup to his disciples, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance." So now, following Jesus' example, we take this bread and this wine, the ordinary things of the world through which God will bless us. And as Jesus offered thanks for the gifts of the earth, let us also celebrate God's goodness. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray. Papa, Mama, Father, Mother, Abba, Amma.
We love you.
Beloved our God, source of our life, creator of all.
We adore you.
Giver of life, bearer of pain, maker of love.
We embrace you.
Your name be hallowed, your name be honored, your name be embodied. Your justice rule us, your shalom unite us, your compassion enfold us.
As in heaven, so on earth.
Your wisdom be our guide, your way be our path, your will be done well.
As in heaven, so on earth.
The bread of our need,
give us today.
The manna of enough,
give us today.
The taste of your tomorrow,
give us today.
Our debts remit,
as we forgive.
Our hurts forgive,
as we forgive.
Your mercy show.
Mercy.
In the hour of a temptation, in times we are tested, in the worst of trials, from the powers that bind, from the coils that trap, from the grip of evil. For yours is the goodness, yours is the joy, yours is the life.
Death.
Yours is the glory.
The
yours is the victory.
The
yours is the world. From time and eternity.
Forever and ever.
For age after age.
Forever and ever.
So be it. Amen.
Amen.
Look, the bread of heaven is broken for the life of the world.
We are as many on one body, for we all share in one bread.
The gifts of God for the people of God.
Let us be what we see and receive what we are.
All are invited at this table. Thank you. After the Last Supper, Jesus and the apostles went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I pray."
Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and began to be distressed and agitated, and he said to them,
"My soul is deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake."
And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that, if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
"Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak."
And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them,
"Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough, the hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. Look, my betrayer is at hand."
Now extinguish the candles and strip the altar. I invite you to say slowly Psalm 22, beginning on bottom of page 19.
Of the congregation of the Thank you.